Welcome to Safe and Sound, a monthly Classic Album Sundays webinar in which we aim to demystify the world of high-end audio with practical tips on how to improve your home listening experience. If you would like to join us for upcoming live webinars, subscribe as a member at patreon.com/Classic Album Sundays.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, patrons. First, I just want to thank you all for becoming patrons in the first month of our Classic Album Sundays subscription offering. It really means a lot to me. When this whole thing happened, we had to figure out a new way to kind of realize Classic Album Sundays, and I came up with this subscription idea. And I'm just so chuffed to bits that you've all joined so early on and have put your faith into us. So thank you so much. And I really appreciate your support. I'm also really excited about all the events that we're doing, including tonight's Safe and Sound webinar, Friday night's pub quiz, and Sunday's album club, the featured album being Kraftwerk, The Man Machine. Of course, due to the recent sad passing of Florian Schneider, but also because that's what you album club members also voted for. It's really great that we're able to do this kind of communication and have you involved in the process of choosing the album. I did mention today in the message to all of you patrons that next month in June, we will space out the events. If any of you have any ideas or any kind of feedback or suggestions, feel free to hit me back with a message, because I am interested in what you have to say, because we are developing this as we go along and I really would love your feedback. The monthly Safe and Sound webinars really represent one of the core values of Classic Album Sundays, which is making your listening experience the best that it can possibly be with whatever given circumstance that you have. Now, at our in-person events, we use world-class audiophile hi-fi. And these systems that we use at our events enable people to hear detailed and nuanced sonic experience, kind of getting as close as we can possibly get to the artist's original intention. But of course, now being on lockdown, we're all listening to music a lot in our own homes. I hope you're all listening to music more than you have in the past. Maybe it's one of the benefits of this whole, one of the things we can actually take out. I shouldn't say a benefit, but it's something we can actually take with us when we do eventually reach the other side, is hopefully we'll continue to listen to a lot more music. So I thought it'd be a good idea to encourage people to improve their own listening experience in their own home. So for the novice, I know the audiophile world can seem a little bit daunting, a little bit scary, a little bit like an exclusive club, but it really doesn't have to be. In fact, my mentor, David Mancuso, said, "Great sound is a human right." And so in this session, the whole purpose is to really kind of demystify high-end audio. Now, John Carroll, who is our special guest tonight, he's a managing director of Loud and Clear Edinburgh. He has over 35 years experience in the audio industry, and he's very well respected and well liked because of his candor, because of his honesty, and because of his great sense of humor. So he has a lot to live up to tonight. And in this evening's Safe and Sound webinar, we aim to show you that everybody really has the ability to make little tweaks, whether it's with room acoustics or with their own sound system set up, that can really make a vast difference to your own listening experience. Because at the end of the day, it's all about enjoying music. So John, thank you so much for joining me. How are you?
Very well, Colleen. How are you? Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too. John's been a supporter.
We're only about 1.4 meters apart, so let's make most
exactly.
of it.
Exactly, he's right there,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But John has been an early supporter of Classic Album Sundays. He's thrown Classic Album Sundays sessions in his own shop, which is a really great shop. But we've also done them together at Edinburgh International Festival as well. So I've known John for a long time, and thank you so much for doing this tonight. We really appreciate it.
No, it's great. It's a great opportunity to actually take what you've just said from the words of Mancuso and extend it a little bit further. It's our duty to bring great sound to the world. You know, that's what we do. both in playing music and putting together systems to replay music. So it's our duty to do so. So let's see what we can give in the way of a few tips for this lovely lockdown.
Okay, that sounds great. Now, we know that it always starts with room acoustics. And, you know, but what are we listening out for? What are the issues and what can we do right now to treat the issues? This is what we'll be talking about in the first section. And before just we go any further, I just want to let you know, we will be doing a Q&A at the end of this session. So if you start to have some questions, what you need to do is press the Q&A tab on the bottom of your screen. And our moderator will take a look at the questions and will choose the questions he feels are suitable and will give you an order, and he'll privately message you to let you know that your question has been chosen and what number you'll be. And then I will call your name. And when it comes time for you to ask your question, don't forget to unmute yourself on the lower left hand of your screen. So let's start now with some room acoustics. John, what's lesson number one? What's the first thing we look out for when we listen to our room?
Okay, well, the first thing you should look out for when you're listening to your room is, first of all, to listen to yourself, listen to your reactions, gauge your own reactions. Music is about sort of self-indulgence and pleasing yourself, you know, exciting emotions and so on. From your days in clubs and your nights in clubs and your early mornings in clubs, you'll know that bass is one of the fast routes to exciting the emotions. But we don't all have the benefit of a big system and a big room. Some of us have little sort of Bluetooth loudspeakers and the small apartments. Some of us have huge big systems crammed into tiny little rooms. And then sometimes we have modest little systems, as we have here, in a modest room. The problem is that we quite often choose our home. We then get a room where we live in. And then we develop our passion for music over the years. And, you know, kind of looking behind you, you've got a few records going on there, Colleen.
Yeah. just a couple.
Which probably, you know, takes up so much more. But actually, what you've created there is a lovely backdrop, both visually and sonically. It's doing two great jobs, three great jobs, because obviously it provides lots of great music for you. But the things that, you know, there are some set rules. One of them is called squaring the triangle. Yeah. Mm. So you have to get things lined up in your listening arrangement. And this can be done in any listening position, in any room. And what you really want to do is triangulate yourself. Now, everyone who's tuned in tonight, I've actually put you in my listening seat. So where you're sitting and where you're looking for from is where you'll actually listen to these two little KEF monitor loudspeakers that are here. Just for a bit of understanding, I'm actually in lockdown in the Highlands of Scotland in my little cottage. So my big record collection, my big hi-fi system, everything's in Edinburgh. So actually, I'm properly challenged at the moment. I'm making the most of my little weekend system, which is lovely. But really what you want to do is triangulate yourself. Predominantly, we're listening in stereo. A left speaker and a right speaker, okay? You want to place yourself equidistant from those loudspeakers. And where possible, you want to put those loudspeakers equidistant from surfaces to the sides, to the back, to the front, above and below. If you don't do that, the loudspeakers will work at different levels. So the sound will be reinforced by their surroundings. Now, we've got a great example here at the moment because I'm in an open plan space. So this speaker over here, the left loudspeaker, is actually got 5 meters to the right of it, completely open. The speaker over here, to the right-hand loudspeaker, is actually hard up against the wall. So down the side wall here, I've put some diffusion panels to scatter some of the energy on this side of the room, to dissipate that, which means that, because as much as 90% of what we hear is reflected sound. Yeah. If anyone's ever been in a thing called an anechoic chamber, where they test all sorts of, not just audio equipment, they test all sorts of equipment. And an anechoic chamber is somewhere created as a test environment so that it doesn't bounce sound back. When you go in there and stand there for more than 3 minutes, you hear the pulse in your ears because you actually start focusing in on the sound around you. What we need to do here is, as I say, is square the room off. So give equal reflections coming back. Don't put your head up against the back wall. Don't put your head against the side wall. Be equidistant from your loudspeakers. That's the basics. Yep, absolute basics.
I just want to just kind of back up a little bit on reflection to what it actually is. So it's the sound coming out of the loudspeaker is hitting any surface and it reflects off of that. So you're almost getting the sound kind of twice.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, in worst case examples, we've spoken about this before, a thing called flutter echo, which is a really bad example. If you go and stand in a concrete stairwell in a car park, a multi-story car park, and clap your hands, and you've got concrete here and concrete there, you'll get an echo going, ding, 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 ding. And that's from emanating from your hand clap. If you're listening to music and it's got a hand clap in it, that's your point source. If that's between two hard surfaces, that sound bounces around.
Also,
now, actually, your worst problem in most rooms are actually not your side walls, but your ceiling and your floor. Because most people don't have a rug on their ceiling. It's usually a flat reflective surface. And quite often, people have hardwood floors, very stripped back, beautiful, lovely wooden floors. But that gives that's a possibility to create a flutter echo because sound doesn't just go left and right, it goes up and down also. That really disturbs the music enjoyment because your mind cannot focus on the fundamental. It gets pulled away to the reflected sound. So what you want to do is not necessarily kill that sound. You've probably spent many hours in radio stations in sound rooms, which are overdamped. And actually listening to textural, enjoyable music in them is not great because it's just too congested. So what you want to do is delay the sound and send it off in different directions and stop the sound from bouncing around.
You kind of want that happy medium. It's a happy medium, isn't it? You don't want it too dead like a studio, but you don't want it too live where the reverb time is over 2 seconds.
Yeah. Now, in the way of testing how your room feels, and we've probably all done it at some point in our life, moved into a new home, which is sparsely furnished and so on, and you sit there naturally and think, it's not quite right yet, needs a little rug, needs a throw, maybe another armchair. Actually, what you're doing subconsciously is acoustically tuning the room to sound nice so that night you come home, open a bottle of wine, put a couple of candles on, put some music on. It's not just because it visually now looks better. Sonically, it's more relaxing. And actually, your music will sound better. So the first challenge is to be able to sit comfortably in your room and think, this is not too bare feeling. It's not too challenging. Simple suggestions before we even get to any audio devices are, you know, a nice, big, comfortable sofa will soak up a lot of reverberant sound. A nice rug on a hardwood floor between you and your loudspeakers gets rid of what they call a first reflection, which is a fast reflection. So this is not the flutter thing we were talking about. This is a hard reflection. You hear the sound from the speaker, quickly followed by the reflection from the floor. And much faster than that, you know, milliseconds, microseconds of delay, and it upsets the mind and we don't enjoy our music. And you may not actually hear it as an echo. but it's there and it will take the pleasure away. So a rug on the floor, that's a great thing.
Yeah. And we were talking before as well about the panels that you have. Like one thing that I believe you can do to find out where those reflective surfaces are on your wall is play some music and then move a mirror along the side of the wall to see where it hits the most. And then would that be the place for to put up some kind of, it could be a tapestry. It doesn't need to be a fancy acoustic panel either, although I did get one for my house recently. But you can use other things that you have around the house.
Here's where my lovely personality comes into things. The real best tuning piece of equipment that you can have is a friend who does what they're told and says nothing.
So I love friends like that.
the perfect friend. And then what you do is you sit in your listening position with your system there, and you get your friend to go around the room, go to the position of your speaker, to your right speaker, and give a clap of the hands. And you can sit there and hear if there are any, because if you create the sound yourself, you're in the wrong position to get the bad result. So you need to always be in, you need to adopt this very, very important task of sitting on the sofa and letting your friend, with a beer, and letting your friend do all the work. But yes, your suggestion of moving a harder panel around will exacerbate the issue. And sometimes the issue can be very, very small. We have a really lovely listening room in Edinburgh, but one of the last tuning elements was there was a really nasty little flutter echo, and it was coming from the top back right-hand corner only. That's what it was. And we put an absorption panel there, about this sort of size, gone. And the musical engagement just changed, absolutely.
Could you hang, because I know a lot of flutter echo comes from like corners of rooms too, because you have like three different surfaces, meaning of your ceiling and two walls, right? Could you put something else, maybe something hanging in a corner that might help disperse the sound?
Yeah, you can do. I mean, there are all sorts of solutions, but actually the good way to test what these... And it quite often it's the top back corner rather than the lower corners, because the lower corners, there are many, many things across the floor, various pieces of furniture. It's that free space from where your speaker is, direct trajectory to the back corner, and nothing in the way on the way there or on the way back to your listening position. So actually a good way to check, and a very cheap way to check, is to get one of these expanding decorating poles or cleaning poles or whatever, and a cushion, and just stuff it up into the corner, both corners, and have a quick listen. And that'll tell you whether that corner is creating a problem or not. If it is, then you find the solution for it. Yeah.
So now we need three people to help out, because you need to be sitting in your listening chair. So this is a good job for teenagers.
It just gets better and better, doesn't it?
It really does. I'll sit here with my beer. You could stand over there with the broomstick with one cushion.
But the important thing is you must remain as the fundamental. Yeah. Because if you start varying the theme by getting up and wandering around, you're really going to upset the plan. So best just sit on the sofa, Colleen, and take it easy. Yeah.
Exactly. Get my bonbons.
Unless, of course, you need another beer. And then you need a fourth friend.
I need a fourth friend to get the beer for me. How many people does it take to get a good listening space?
Yeah.
Okay, so... There's another thing that I've heard that you can also do, because we do this in recording studios too, is of course tilting the glasses is tilted, so you could angle down picture frames or things hanging on your wall as well, so it's not
absolutely
a complete flat surface.
Yeah, problem with a lot of pictures are that And this is actually where you can get a little bit experimental. You can get all these lovely box canvas pieces of artwork, so where the artwork follows around the edges of the box canvas. Those are fantastic, because you can have a fantastic piece of artwork, oil painting, photography, whatever you want, silkscreen, and in behind the box, you can actually put some acoustic foam. So you can have artwork that does the job. The tilting can be advantageous, but it can also be problematic.
Right.
Because, you are firing it. If you look at very sophisticated diffusion panels, vented diffusion panels, what you'll actually see is that the depth of each vent and the angle of each vent is different. And if you actually take a microphone and put it in to each vent and speak into the vent and move from vent to vent, you'll get a different sound that comes back from each one. And that's the making of a really good diffusion panel. You also get, as you'll see over behind, we'll take a closer look later, I put a couple of panels here. One's a vented panel and one's a scatter panel. So it's got random machining on it, and it diffuses and absorbs at the same time, which is why I have it in this corner behind this loudspeaker, to take a little bit of the zing and a little bit of the excess energy away from this corner.
Yeah.
But, you know, for home, we're in lockdown at the moment, so we have to improvise. So there are a few basics that you can look at.
Mm-hmm.
Put a rug on the floor. If you've got way too much bass and there's a fair amount of distance behind you, where you're listening on your sofa and the back of the room, get a single listening chair and push the sofa to the back of the room, because a big stuffed sofa is a very good bass trap.
Yeah,
so that that can soak up sound for you. Also, in a lot of homes, the problem literally gets worse every year as televisions get bigger and bigger and bigger. You know, people are putting 60-inch, 65-inch, 80-inch flat-screen TVs between their loudspeakers. That's just like the worst thing you can do, because sound doesn't just come out direct to you. It diffracts. And it really, having this big hard glass surface between your loudspeakers, it creates huge acoustic problems. And what you lose is the depth of image and the focal image. So if you're listening to a really nice solo vocalist, or even a strong rock vocalist for that matter, or a solo jazz musician, you want to be able to pinpoint them between your two loudspeakers. You don't want to be hearing left and right. You want to be hearing individually placed instruments.
Mm-hmm.
If you have this big, hard, reflective surface in the middle, you're going to lose that. So what do? Pick up your 80-inch television and move it every time you want to
listen to music. You get your four friends to do it.
But let's say you're in proper lockdown and you're not doing that sort of home party thing. Then what you may want to do is just take a throw and put it over the TV. You know what? Give it a try. It costs nothing. You know, listen with, listen without. See what you think. Pretty much every time I've tried it, it's vastly improved. Other simple solutions can be decoupling your loudspeakers from the mechanics of the room, because a lot of, if we move away from the reflected sound and more onto the resonance and sound, it's very important, because what you'll actually find is that if your loudspeaker is hard coupled to, particularly most builds of houses now, have some form of cavity in the wall, and the walls act like a drum skin. So you want to do a form of decoupling. And if you can decouple.
And do you want to explain exactly what decoupling is for people that don't understand?
If you can decouple, i.e., the base of the loudspeaker, if it's on a shelf, you want to put something between the loudspeaker and the shelf. Different material is a way to do it. So the shelf will be made of a different material to the loudspeaker. You want to use a third material. And that will stop a lot of excitement getting into the shelf and then transferring into the walls. Or if you've got loudspeaker stands, down into the floor and perhaps into the cavity of the floor. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of things you can do, but you know, at the moment we can't run down to our local hi-fi store or our local electronics store to buy these gadgets or even our DIY store to make things. So you may have to improvise. So simply you can take a square section of wood, cut it up into little blocks and use little wooden blocks. I would always suggest three rather than four.
Yeah. Oh, really? Why is that?
Yeah. Because you think of how many four-legged camera tripods have you
That's
seen?
That's true. Yeah. Yeah. I was just also thinking about the Riga turntable too. Like they have three.
3 feet. Yeah. 3 feet. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of high-end audio equipment has 3 feet rather than 4 feet. The reason being is with four points of contact, you get a little bit of teetering. And don't forget, music is exciting and creating resonance. So you're forcing everything. If it's got a little bit of movement capability, it's going to move. Yeah? Yeah. If you have 3 points of contact, it effectively self-anchors, a bit like a tripod. So even if it's off to one side, it's not going to rock. Yeah. We'll come back to other points later on in the session, but don't just be obsessed with reflections, because you may start doing things that put other problems into the room. Right. Don't upset the harmony of the room by moving things around too much, and always try one thing at a time.
Yes. Don't try one thing at a time. That's right. That's really good advice.
Yeah.
That's really good advice. Before we actually leave this area, I just want to also talk about bass a bit more, because bass can be both your enemy and your best friend.
Of course you do.
Because bass, how low can you go?
Yeah.
Now, bass, we sometimes some rooms you need to, maybe you need to have less bass. Bass is, there's too much bass is a problem. Whereas with the two kind of bookshelf speakers you have there and the one that I have up here behind me in this room, of course, I might want more bass. So why don't we talk a little bit? I think a lot of people listening might have smaller bookshelf speakers, and maybe they want to enhance the bass rather than take it out.
Absolutely. The other thing is, the irony of it is, small loudspeakers tend to sound at their best when you turn them up a bit. Mm. Yeah. That's the reason. There's a solid reason for that. They're not producing as much natural bass as a big loudspeaker. When you turn them up, they drive more energy into the room, and they then find loading points to give you more reflected bass back. So that's why small loudspeakers sound better on the bass end when you turn them up. Big loudspeakers tend to sound quite naturally full and wholesome, even at lower volume levels. That's because you have the internal air volume of the big cabinet and usually bigger drive units to give you that sound pressure wave. Mm. So they'll tend to give you more satisfying bass at low levels. So going back to the small loudspeaker, and let's take it to the extreme case of you're stuck at home, you're locked up, and all you've got is your little Bluetooth loudspeaker, and your room's 8 meters square. Yeah, it's going to really struggle to give lots of bass. So you go back to the classic corner horn designs of Klipsch and Tannoy and so on, where what they would have done is, instead of having a freestanding loudspeaker, they would have built corner loudspeakers, sometimes with triangular cabinets so they could go hard into the corner. Yeah. So you would take your small loudspeaker and you would put it into the corner position in a room, yeah? Mm-hmm. That way, it uses the reinforcement and it starts to use the room as a cabinet, yeah? And you'll get more textural bass at a lower volume level, and then when you turn it up, you'll get even more. So you get your real party feel going on with a tiny little loudspeaker. But, you know, a little bookshelf loudspeaker like this, correctly positioned, pushed out, using the room to load the sound, pushing it a bit more into the corners, that'll really, really work. Mm-hmm. But bass arrives at you in wavelengths. Yeah. So actually, sometimes moving yourself will give you more bass.
Yes, that's true. Because yes, they're very long. They're very long waves. So sometimes, like, I'll just be sitting on my couch and moving my head ahead and then back, and just trying to find that good spot where it just seems like everything is right, you know?
Absolutely. And sometimes actually pushing yourself further back in the room, it does two things. It gives you more bass loading off of the back corners. It also changes the energy balance, because you actually start to lose some of the mid-range and high-frequency energy, which is much more directly fired at you and less room-loaded. So you actually change the what we call the tilt on the sound. So more top end will arrive if you're closer to the speaker, and less bass, because you get less wave development. You move further away from it, you'll get more bass loading and less high frequency energy. So positioning yourself further away from the loudspeaker could also be your solution.
Absolutely, trying to find that sweet spot, basically.
Flip it the other way around, and you've got a big pair of loudspeakers in a small room. Sometimes you can then have a real issue that you start getting standing waves of bass. Mm. And this is where you have to trap the bass so that you listen mainly off of the loudspeaker rather than to this second and third arrival bass cascade as it develops back and forward, up and down the room. That really is it can be fun for a short period of time, but if you're actually trying to follow the tune in the bass, it just kills it completely. So really with that's if you do have a much higher end system, a higher performance system, then you really want to be getting yourself some bass traps. And actually, even if you don't have too much or perceivably too much bass, it's always worth trying them out anyway, because quite often you'll find that you don't notice a bass reduction, but you notice an improvement in the musical engagement and the coherence through the mid-band and the high frequency. Mm. Because when a loudspeaker designer sets out to design the loudspeaker, you'll think, people are going to use this in their home. I want them to use in this within these parameters, but they cannot compensate for every room in the world. So you've got to tune your room to the loudspeaker. Yes. And most of that tuning is done at the bass end rather than the top end.
Yep, because the top end is directional and bass is omnidirectional.
Absolutely, yeah.
Do you want to head over to the other spot so we could talk about what we can need to do with cabling and actually set up?
Okay, I will tell them what we're going to do and I'll move on.
Yeah. That sounds good. Yeah, thank you. So what we're talking about as well with bass traps, one thing you can do at home if you feel like there's a lot of bass that's getting trapped in a corner is you could put different things in that corner. You could put soft furnishings, you could put a soft furnished chair, you could even do a big plant. I mean, even though the bottom part would be very hard and reflective, the plant itself would be both absorption and dispersion. So there are different things you can play around with. I think you just need to see what you have at home that you can use, but find that sweet spot in your room, have a listen. Get your friends, get your teenage kids, or whoever it is that can help you right now, to find out where those reflective surfaces are. And these are things you can do at home right now, and it doesn't cost any money at all. Now, another thing that really annoys me when I go to, I see or hear different systems, and also maybe it's because I'm a Virgo and very organized, I don't like seeing, electric mains cabling touching or anywhere near audio cabling, because you get a lot of interference, and there's a lot of different things that you can, so that's one thing that you should be doing automatically. Any kind of audio cabling, whether it's interconnects or speaker cabling, should be kept separate and should not be up against mains cables because of different kinds of radio frequency interference, RFI, or electromagnetic interference. So that's one thing that you can do right away, making sure that your mains cables, anything that's going into the wall, that's getting power, that should be kept completely distinct and separate from all audio cabling. John's also going to talk us through some other ways which you can decouple your turntable and other pieces of equipment. John, are you back with us?
I am indeed, yeah.
There he is. Okay, I can hear you, yes. So why don't you walk, I can hear you beautifully. So why don't we talk a little bit about the turntable? I can see that you're getting your spirit level ready.
Yeah. Okay, so as I said, this is a fairly moderate and modest system, but it doesn't mean that you can't optimize it. So actually going to your point of the cabling, the smaller the signal is in an audio system, the more susceptible it is to interference. Within the makeup of most audio systems, and with the huge popularity of vinyl and turntable playback, the smallest signal that we deal with actually comes from your cartridge over to your amplifier to the phono stage, where it's pre-amplified before it goes to the main amplifier, which means that the signal that's coming down here and to down the cable to the amplifier is super susceptible to interference. So in this setup here, actually the cable, this one here, is dressed away from all of the mains cables that are at the back. So it comes out of the arm, goes forward, across, round, and into the back of the amplifier here. So it's not near any other cables at all. The other way that you can deal with interference in cables is, can you see this okay?
Yes. Yeah.
Is that you can shield the cable. So a lot of good cables have very good shielding on them. That's very important, again, for turntables. But the shielding picks up interference. You then have to decide where you're going to send that. If it's merely just connected at the other end of the cable, it just picks up the interference and sends it into your amplifier. So quite often what you can do is you have a third connector here. You have your left and right for your turntable connection. And then this is your ground cable. But you can actually wire up cables in different ways. And a good audio dealer will help people with this, to sort out the ground path and the shielding path for the interference, to make sure that it doesn't get mixed in with your signal again. The most noticeable way that you'll perceive this in a turntable playback system and listening to vinyl is in the form of a hum. Yeah. And in worst case scenario, sometimes the cable's even microphonic. So if you actually squeeze the cable, you'll hear it through your loudspeakers. If you do that and you hear a noise through your loudspeakers, you know you've got a problem. Mm. Yeah. So routing of the cable, keeping signal cables, so the connection between your individual audio components, which is usually done on phono plugs or XLR plugs, keeping those away from the mains cables. So when I put together a multi-box system, usually what I'll do is find the position for the boxes, all the individual pieces of equipment, what we call dress in the mains cables and route them all carefully, and keep them in one group, and then put the signal cables in and dress them away from the other cables. Yeah.
When you say dress, is that like trunking?
Yeah. Well, you don't have to put them in trunking. You can, it's also not good to hard cable tie things either, yeah, because you don't want to grip two separate cables together, mm-hmm, but you can use soft Velcro strips just to keep things out of the way and to keep things apart. So it's dressing in that you're just laying out the cables properly. Yeah.
Okay.
So it's just a little bit of care and attention rather than just plug, plug, plug and leave the spaghetti behind it, which is what normally happens. Yeah.
It's awful.
Yeah. So actually, you know, if you're really bored in lockdown and you've got a, if you've got a turntable and a phono amp and an amplifier and a CD player or a music streamer, lots of different boxes and speaker cables and power cables, just unplug everything, take it all off the shelf, and then put them back one at a time, put the mains cable in, next one, mains cable, next one, mains cable, and try and have all the mains cables off to one side, and then start connecting up the audio cables and keep them away from the mains cables rather than having everything twisting over each other. Mm-hmm. And pretty much every time it will sound better. But there is one other little reason why it sounds better, because the sheer mechanics of actually unplugging a cable and plugging it back in cleans the point of contact.
That's really good. I mean, that's interesting too, because sometimes when you do get a little, when you do get strange sounds, that is one thing that I always test first, is all the points of contact. And sometimes it gets quite dirty. Excuse me.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, they're all made of metal, and to a lesser or greater extent, most metal oxidizes. And just that metal rubbing over metal as you plug and unplug things, mm-hmm. it cleans the point of contact. If you get better contact or reduced contact resistance by not having oxidation in the way, you'll get better conductivity. And in the way of any audio equipment, the cleanest signal path, including all the connection points, is actually one of the most important things. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So unplugging and plugging back in can actually sometimes just improve the sound of your system.
Now, with the turntable, you were talking about decoupling your loudspeakers earlier. I think with a turntable is probably one of the most important components that needs decoupling out of your entire system.
Yeah. So turntable, electromagnetic device, basically small points of mechanical movement here from the needle in the groove of the record generates very, very small amounts of electrical current in the form of signal down to the amplifier. So if you exacerbate that by having resonance, and you've got a resonance maker up here getting picked up by the turntable, that will effectively turn it into signal that shouldn't be there, okay?
Think of your stylus like a microphone as well.
Absolutely, absolutely. The technology is virtually the same on this. So two things that you want to do. The other thing that will create unwanted signal is the stylus moving in the wrong direction. So the first thing you have to do is make sure that your record is flat and totally level, yeah? Because if it's slightly off to one side, as the needle's riding the groove both horizontally and vertically, the movements will be wrong. Mm-hmm. So it's trying to go up and down vertically, but because the record's not flat, it's not giving you back to the signal that it should be giving you. So I've actually done something here, very, very simple tweak. The turntable's leveled using a simple crossbow spirit level here, or two crossbows, which are two little ball bearings. Mm-hmm. And if they meet in the middle, it's level. Now, if your shelf's not level and there's no way of adjusting it because you're not on a piece of adjustable custom audiophile furniture, just some coins underneath the contact points, yeah? So there's £2 coins here, and there's a £1 coin there, and there's none at the back, because this is a big piece of timber that this is sitting on, which with the best will in the world is not completely flat. So there's a £3 upgrade there, and you'll see that the turntable is absolutely rock solid, yeah? Mm-hmm. No movement in it, and perfectly level.
Yes. And also you were talking before about the wood that you're using as well. Now that is a very good material for isolating as well.
Yeah, yeah. So we take this setup here. We've got different materials in the setup, and this is always something to look at. So we've got big solid piece of natural timber. We've got aluminium feet. We've got a composite material plinth, and these feet also have little rubber tips on them. So we've got various different types of material all the way up. Every material has, at any size, has a natural resonant frequency. So it has a natural frequency that it rings at. So you take a piece of glass and it will ring at quite a high frequency if you tap a big sheet glass window. If you take a piece of timber like this, it's quite dead. So the resonant frequency is quite low, yeah? Mm-hmm. If the piece of timber was way bigger, you could actually get standing waves in it. It could start oscillating. we've all probably done the thing with a rope or a skipping rope where you shake it and eventually you get a wave created if it's long enough, yeah, or a hose pipe or whatever. But different materials will get rid of these standing waves and resonant frequencies again. But very, very importantly, the turntable must be flat. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. The first thing that I do, even in DJ sets, it's the first thing I do after the DJ before me, flatten out the turntables. Yeah. And some other time we'll do a complete turntable setup webinar with John as well. There's a lot that you can do, but it's just there's so much to talk about that it's probably best saved for another time.
I'm going to give you one little free tip, though, for your turntable. Not for your DJ turntables, because most of them tend to be direct drive, which brings its own set of problems, as you know. But most turntables now that people are buying are belt drive turntables. It's a rubber band running from the motor, making the platter going round. This one, you can actually see the drive belt. Drive belts wear out really quickly, yeah? They stretch, they get polished, and so on and so forth. You can actually rejuvenate them. So you can take your rubber drive belt off, get some not boiling but quite warm water in a bowl, yeah? Drop the drive belt in it and leave it there for about 5 or 6 minutes. Take it out and pat it dry with some paper towel and you'll rejuvenate your drive belt.
Oh, wow. If
you're stuck at home and you didn't get around to getting yourself a new drive belt for your turntable, and it's got a little bit of wow in the sound, and you think it's maybe running a bit slow because the belt's slipping, take the belt off into some fairly warm water, leave it there for 5 or 6 minutes, take it out, pat it dry, put it back on. It takes all the polishing and sheen off of it, so it's grippier, and then being in the warm water for a period of time just shrinks the drive belt down by a couple of millimeters, which is usually enough to compensate for the stretching that it's had over the years.
That's great. That's a really good, I never even knew about that. That's a really good one. I just went out and bought a new one. But we can't do that right now. So that's a really good idea.
You can't do that right now. When you do get a new one, another little tip for you is on a belt drive turntable, when you start it, the power button on this one's at the side. As you start it, give it a kick to get it going. And the drive belt will last 10 times as long.
Yes.
Just by doing that.
Just by giving it a little head start, a little push.
Little head start, yeah.
Is there anything else you want to discuss over in this corner? Or do you want to head back to your...
Two things very quickly before we go. This is a nice little amplifier here. This is an all-in-one system, a little moon system with a phone stage and an amplifier and a music streamer. It's a busy box, but it's got a big transformer in it. You don't want to transfer, transformers resonate. You don't want to transfer that resonance into the turntable. So I've isolated this from the shelf because it's on the same shelf as the turntable at the moment. But also you want to have a combination of coupling and decoupling. So you want it to sit hard. So it's on three cones again. These little cones here, and made of various materials. So some of them are titanium and ceramic. Some of them are bronze and ceramic and brass and ceramic. Some of them are aluminium and ceramic, and they all have different resonant frequencies. So we're actually controlling the resonance again. So there are lots of different things in here. Little microprocessors, little surface mount capacitors, and so on, that are sensitive to certain frequencies. Then you have other elements of the system that are susceptible to other resonant frequencies in a bad way. So controlling those different frequencies can fundamentally improve the sound of the amplifier. And then just going back to your room acoustics, we get a closer look. Here we've got a speaker very close to a corner, in a little alcove. So we've got two different types of panels here. Both of them are absorbing and also scattering the sound as well. So we're not bouncing the sound around in this alcove. We're actually taming it, controlling some of it, and creating a balance because the speaker on the other side is an open space.
That's great. Well, as you head back, I'm going to start getting some questions together from people out there. Now is the time for you to ask your own questions. If you have a question, please press the Q&A bubble and our moderator will get to you and see what your question is before putting you on. But it's a really good time to ask John maybe about the specifics of your own room and sound system, because different shape sizes, different rooms shapes and sizes, ceiling heights, these all come into play with room acoustics, and you might have very specific questions, and I'm sure that John will be happy to answer it as well. We've spoken about so many different things in terms of isolation and separation of different audio signal cables with mains cables. We've talked about speaker placements. And one thing I did want to mention about speaker placement is you really should check the manufacturer's specs. Because a lot of different speakers have different characteristics, and they may say be a meter away from the back wall, or like a clip shorn, you want to be jammed right into the corner. So that's something you really need to check with the manufacturer. We have our first question is from Kay.
Hi, Kay.
Hello there. I've got a question about home, actually. I've got some new speakers. Plugged into a very old amp, which has just come out of storage, and there's a slight hum. So I'm thinking something's not earthed properly, but I'm not quite sure what that is. It's not the turntables, because everything's humming when it comes to your laptop as well.
Oh, okay. So the hum comes from the loudspeaker?
Yeah.
And is it volume dependent? So when you turn the amplifier up, does it get louder?
That's a good question. Rob, does it get louder when we turn the audio?
Didn't try that,
actually, sorry.
Okay, so that's one of your first tests, mm-hmm. is make sure you can hear the hum, turn the volume up without any music playing, and see if it gets louder, yeah? Mm-hmm. If it gets louder, what you then know is that the problem is probably upstream from the amplifier. So outside the amplifier, I between there and the source, the laptop, and it's very probably a ground hum. So it could be that the amplifier is not getting a proper ground. So that earthed. Some people call it ground, some people call it earthed. It's very noticeable. Are you in the UK? Yeah.
Yeah, London.
Okay, so your ground hum is going to be very noticeable because it will be 50 hertz. And I shall give you my quick impersonation of a ground hum. It goes something like this. That's 50 hertz. Yeah. If it's, it's not ground. So if it's, that's some form of electrical interference. Will be a much higher frequency oscillation. But if it's a,
the lower end.
Yeah. That's something to do with grounding. So the first thing I would actually check is if it's an old amplifier, mm-hmm. undo your 13 amp plug top, and make sure that the ground connection is screwed down nice and tight.
Oh, okay. That's easy.
If you say it's an old amplifier, you might find that someone has actually fitted that plug 20 years ago, 25, 30 years ago. So the other thing, you remember what I was saying about cleaning up the contact point?
Yeah.
Mains cable tends to be made of copper. The copper will be probably dark brown or green by now. So bare back the cable a little bit until it looks nice and shiny and make a nice new connection.
I think it's because it's going into an adapter, because it's a New Zealand plug. It's going into a UK adapter, and maybe that's the problem.
Oh, right. Okay. So that's very likely to be your problem. Adapters never give a good ground contact.
Ta-da.
Because I'm not going to bore everyone with why. Just get rid of the adapter and fit a proper plug. It'll cost you 50 pence.
Brilliant.
Fantastic. That's a really great advice. Thank you, Kay.
Thank you.
The next person we have is Salim. Hi, Salim. Are you there, Salim?
I am now. I was muted. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you, Salim. How are you?
Hi, Salim. Thank you. Hi, John. Yeah, good stuff. All interesting tips and so on. So, yeah, we should be applying those to some some of those to my system. But the question I have, you mentioned earlier about the drive belt, and you said before then that direct drive turntables have some particular problems. I just wonder if you just quickly could identify what those problems might be. I actually do use a direct drive turntable, so I do use the good old Technics SL1200 in my system. Torrens turntable, which I had for many, many years. Just curious.
Okay, so your Torrens was probably a belt drive turntable, TD150, 160, 166, something like that. The direct drive turntables, it depends on how they do the direct drive. Most older designs, and actually Technics have done some very high-end audiophile turntables in recent years. Colleen, you've probably lusted after one or got yourself one already.
Mine's modified. My original 1200's already modified.
Yeah, but the one bit that they can't change on the old 1200 that's massively improved on the new reference decks is the motor drive system. Mm. And what direct drive turntables suffer from is a thing called cogging.
Yeah,
because they're not actually direct drive, so the motor's not connected to the platter. It uses an electromagnetic pulsing. Yeah, so old direct drive turntables, it was quite literally a motor that turned the platter round.
Yeah.
On a Technics, it's a electromagnetic pulsing, so it pulses like this, a bit like a cordless power drill. The way that it spins round, so it creates a pulse. But because it's much lower speed than a turntable, you get a thing called cogging, so which is like an oscillation. So it pulses the movement of the turntable. Very, very good direct drive motors now no longer have this cogging effect, so it's smooth, very smoothly driven. Really, there's not an awful lot you can do about it. You can. There are some people who make great power supplies for Technics turntables, off-board power supplies, and that massively reduces that problem, and also takes the power supply from inside of the deck and puts it outside, which means that you don't get the interference and cross-pollination issues with the noise created by the power supply being picked up by the very delicate wires inside.
Right. Salim, that's what I have. My turntable has an external power supply unit, PSU. And if you want that done to your turntable, I have you in London.
I've done exactly that. So I've got an external turntable and a different arm on it and all the other bearing mods and all that kind of stuff.
But great.
I just wondered if the new one was really worth the upgrade or not. But maybe I'll pick myself to a new one at some point.
Salim, if I was to pinpoint the single biggest area of improvement of design from the old Technics decks to what they're doing now, it's in that motor drive system.
Gotcha. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah,
great. Thanks, Salim.
You're welcome.
The next question is from Tom. Tom, are you there?
Is there anything simple that can be done to reduce the amount of bass my downstairs neighbours are receiving? Will a rug under the desk with my speakers on it help at all?
Okay, this is where it'd be good to ask Tom a couple of questions. So if his speakers are on the floor, if what he probably wants to do is create some form of little isolation plinth. If he wants to very, very cheaply test it, get a couple of big wooden chopping boards, and sit the loudspeakers on top of the wooden chopping boards with maybe a soft material underneath the chopping board between the floor boards and the chopping board. So like a couple of mouse mats are really good, you know, the neoprene mouse mats, something like that. And see if that does, because what you're doing is you're mechanically decoupling the loudspeaker from the floor. Yeah. That's quite a good way to do it, yeah.
Tom's just managed to say he's got bookshelf speakers on a desk.
Bookshelf speakers
on a desk, and his neighbors can hear it downstairs, I guess. That's the issue.
Yeah, good.
Wow, okay. So there's a good possibility there that actually the resins, we spoke about the cavity in the walls, yeah? In a lot of properties in apartments, that weren't built very recently, you can actually get a lot of noise travel in the cavity of the wall between the apartments, so rather than through the floor. So what I would suggest he does is maybe just turn his desk around and put it on an internal wall rather than an external wall and see if that improves the issue. Because internal walls tend not to be connected top to bottom. External walls, quite often the cavity travels all the way down to the next apartment, or indeed up the way.
So Gina, you have a question for us, Gina?
Yes, I do. Hi.
Hi, Gina.
Hi, Gina. So I've got the luxury. I've got two setups. The speakers that I have in my bedroom, the KEF, which I think is what you've got, John?
Yeah, those are little KEF LS50s, yeah.
They work. That bedroom, I didn't really do anything to it, but clearly the soft furnishings are working really well, and they sound amazing in there. So that all set up is great. But downstairs, the Bowers & Wilkins 607s,
yep.
I'm not getting them to sound... I want to say bassy, but it's not really that. It's just not as deep as the KEFs. And it is much more stark here. It's where I've got all my records, and mm-hmm. there's a lot of bare wall. There is a couple of... There's an armchair and a sofa, but it's also got... I don't know. I feel as if looking at this room, it doesn't have enough padding. So I was wondering about trying to get some panels. How many does one get? Do you start off by getting a couple, the foam panels? Is it okay, a question of number of panels or the size of each panel or literally the location?
I mean, I have a quick question for you, a couple of quick questions. Are the loudspeakers equidistant from the back wall?
They are. So they're on either side of my fireplace, and there's records filling the alcoves. So they're,
okay,
they're
gotcha.
Not as far, to be fair. Colleen did say, you know, look in, see what the manufacturer states. They're not a meter in from the wall because... I don't have that sort of space.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I would suggest is that sometimes to get the bass texture, you kill the stereo image. And sometimes to get the stereo image, you kill the bass texture. So first of all, two simple tests. I bring them quite close together and quite flat and sit quite close to them. So create a small triangular arrangement and mm-hmm. listen to really, really decide whether you actually like the sound of the loudspeaker or not. So mm-hmm. you're that's what we would call a near field monitor position. Yeah. So mm-hmm. you're actually quite close. So everything that you're hearing is really off of the loudspeaker. The other thing to do is take the loudspeaker, both of them, and push them into the corners of the room. And see if the loudspeaker, that's going to give the loudspeaker the very best possible chance of bass loading the room. And if it doesn't actually over bass load the room, the speaker's not right for the room. It's just not cutting it. So if you can't get too much bass texture by pushing them right into the corners, then the speaker is just not right for you and not right for the room.
Okay, that's great.
Do that before you spend even a penny, or as Colleen would say, a dime, on on any acoustic treatment. Okay, because acoustic helpful. Treatment can really start adding up in price. Mm. And quite often, you're actually taking energy away rather than giving energy back. So try the extreme position things, first of all. Colleen will share out my contact details.
Yes.
So if you want to, this is probably one that you want to bounce back and forward a few questions on. So I'm more than happy to help you through the process.
That's great. Can I just, one follow up on that is, at the moment I've got them facing either side in against the alcoves onto the sofa. But another option would be to have them facing, it's a Victorian house, so one of those alcoves, the wooden window alcove. But then I felt that the sound was not coming to me in the alcove, it was hitting the inside walls, if that makes sense. So I was missing.
Yes, yeah, yeah. I mean, on that one, you know, if we can stay in touch on it, and you can maybe just do me a very, very rudimentary sketch up of your room and the two layouts that you've tried, just with rough dimensions, you know, 5 meters, 6 meters, 7 meters. It doesn't have to be precise. I can give you a couple of test points to try the loudspeakers in.
But you really are
going to be in an area of trial and error on this one.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Thank you, Gina.
You're welcome.
Well, John, thank you so much. This has all been extremely helpful, incredibly helpful. And it's great to have all these different takeaways of things that we can do straight away whilst in isolation, things that we might be able to use that we already have, changing speaker positions, changing our own position, getting our mates over to help us find the where all our reflective surfaces are. And we hugely appreciate it. If any of you want to contact John, John, again, is a managing director of Loud and Clear in Edinburgh. And their shop is still online and hopefully reopening in July. But you can hear that John is able to really demystify high-end audio and speak about it in, you know, normal people, layperson's terms. And I think the fact that you all felt so comfortable asking him questions is really testament to how he's able to convey these really kind of basic principles and very easy techniques that can vastly, vastly improve your own home listening experience. John, do you have any closing words?
Yeah, I've just got one little tip to finish on, which is to do with physical positioning. I strongly suggest that everyone goes now, gets a drink, puts on some music, and puts their feet up and just kick back and enjoy life a little bit. Other than that, stay tuned and make sure that your next mate that you get happens to own a hi-fi store.
I have quite a few. John, thank you so much. I want to thank all of you patrons again for supporting and for being part of this. I could see that you are all quite engaged because everybody stayed through the seminar. That really makes me very happy. John, we'll hopefully see you sometime in the near future at another Safe and Sound webinar, possibly doing turntable setup. And for some of you, I will see you on this Friday for the album pub quiz. And some of you I'll see on Sunday for the album club this month featuring Kraftwerk, The Man Machine. So thanks again to John. Thanks again to our moderator. And thanks to all of you for listening. Take care.
Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.